We are back on Fresh Waves. I'm your host, Bren Masson, and we've got Luanne Donahoe in the studio with us this morning. And now on the line from Ottawa, Ontario, the capital of the country, we have Anna Krutowska. Did I say that? I didn't say that correctly, did I? You can introduce yourself.
It's okay. It's Anna Krutowska.
Krutowska. Okay. Almost got it right.
It's okay. All right. No worries. Difficult Polish last name.
So, Anna, you and Luanne met because both of you have lost a husband who was a first responder, and yours was a police officer. Tell us a little bit about that.
My husband was Eric Chapnik. He was Ottawa police officer who died in the line of duty on December 29, 2009. We are going to be commemorating the 10th anniversary very soon. Eric was a police officer who was responding to a violent sexual assault at the library in Metcalf, which is a little town close to Ottawa, and he followed the ambulance with the victim to the Ottawa Civic Hospital, and he was writing a report in a cruiser, and right at the entrance to the hospital, emergency entrance to the hospital, and he was approached by a man who was appeared looking like a detective, and he attacked him. We don't know the details exactly how it went on because there were only two of them there, he was stabbed and he died following that attack.
Wow. And yes. So you went through the same similar thing that Luanne did with all of the memorials, and it's a very public thing, isn't it?
Yes. So in my case, it was very, very public, because it was in the city of Ottawa. The previous time that the Ottawa police experienced in the line of duty death was around 27 years before Eric. So it was shocking. Ottawa is used to be known as a even though it's a capital, as a smaller town with less violence, and it was pretty striking for a lot of people. It wasn't only for our first responders community, but for the public in general. Eric also was killed right at the entrance to the emergency of the Ottawa Civic Hospital, which is there are paramedics there, there are emergency doctors right there, and just the violence of that attack. I think it really shook the community. It was very, very public. The funeral was very public. We had something like 4,000 people to come through for the wake. I don't remember the numbers, but anywhere between 7,000 and 10,000 people attended the funeral. Very public murder trial of the assailant. That was very public as well.
And how did you and your family find that? I mean, that's a lot of standing and looking, like with the world looking at you kind of thing, as opposed to getting your own private time to be together and to mourn.
You know what, to tell you the truth, I heard from others that it was very difficult. I'll be very honest with you. The reporters and media here in Ottawa were very respectful towards us. I truly appreciate, I did not have people standing, on my front lawn with cameras and microphones. I did not have that. The police obviously did ask that we are asking for privacy. So I must say that for me, it was I understand it was very public, but I personally did not, I was not bothered by the media or any people from the public. People were, usually when people saw me in the store and they just basically recognized me from the newspaper or the TV or interview or something like that, they were very, very respectful. They would approach, they would chat, they would just say they're very, very sorry, they're thinking and praying. I did not find it very difficult for me. I found it, for example, during the trial, the media, I'm from Poland, so my family's in Poland. The trial was ongoing, and media, for example, were tweeting the results or communication that was coming from the courtroom. And I actually was thankful because my family could follow that back in Poland. I couldn't do it. I was attending the court. I was exhausted at the end of the day. I had no strength to call the family and tell them how they went, but they could follow. So it's sort of double-edged sword, you know what I mean? But I did not find that the media and the public were offensive towards us in any way.
Well, that's good to hear. Good to hear. So you and Luanne met at camp.
Yes, correct.
I mean, it sounds absurd, but there's actually a camp, FACES. And what does FACES stand for?
Oh my, now you've got me. I think I have to go here on the internet.
Okay, I've got it. Family and Children of Emergency Services.
Okay, perfect. Yes. To us, it's just come FACES, and we know exactly the meaning, but the actual acronym, I wouldn't be able to tell you, but I should learn it.
So you actually met at this camp, and is the camp specifically for widows and their families?
Well, it's specifically for families. It doesn't have to be widows. We do have widowers as well. Now, not a lot of them, but particularly, it's usually moms with children who come. We do have some moms who basically, or families that do not have children, so widows without children who come, and they're always welcome. So, it's for families who experience loss in the first responders' family. So that includes paramedics, it includes fire and police.
Okay, so you guys were there, and how was it? Was it weird, or was it?
Well, you know what? The first year was you know, for me, my experience the first year when I came there. First of all, in a sense, I was lucky because I had a network of police widows that we were in touch with. That network, it's an organization that was started post 2010. It's called SOL, Survivors of Law Enforcement. Mm-hmm. And basically, it's an organization. So I knew through that organization widows of other fallen police officers, and we were in touch. So when I came to camp, it was sort of a lot of familiar faces. There were some new faces, like Luanne. You know, for me, this is the first time I met Luanne. But I already knew some families, and I knew the stories and so forth. But some families were new. And what I found is that the first few years at the camp, it was very difficult. It's a therapy that sort of, when you go in, it reopens all the wounds, and it brings you back to day zero and of your life, you know, that tragic moment, and you have to relive it in order to, I think, you know, have meaningful relationships. It's important to share your story, but when you share that story, you reopen that wound. You hear other people's stories, and sometimes you're feeling sorry for yourself, and sometimes you're looking at that other person and you say, oh my God, how did she survive or he survive that? So it's difficult. And then when I found it exhausting, both mentally and physically. The camp runs for 4.5 days, and I'll tell you, it's like almost like a truck hits you. You need a few days to recover, or good week or two to recover from it. But I think overall, it is very, very helpful. I think it's important to share your story. It's important to hear other stories, and to basically be able to support each other. I think it's very helpful.
It seems to be. That seems to be a really good program. Where is the camp?
So the first few years, the camp was in Fern Resort in Orillia, mm-hmm. and now it has moved to Blue Mountain area. And I forget the resort right now that we are staying at, but it's a Blue Mountain area.
And where do they get the funding for a camp like that?
It's all fundraised through first responders organizations, so like police associations are supporting, and same thing with firefighters organizations, paramedics, they're doing a lot of fundraising. So it's all non-profit organization, and everything is raised funds for the camp.
Okay. Now, you and Luanne, I don't want to speak for you because you're sitting right here. you guys are also part of an organization that is, or together, you're talking to the government about getting funding for the families of first responders who've died in the line of duty.
So I'm not sure if there's an organization, but basically yes, we're trying to advocate for additional funding. There was a I'm sorry, was it Luanne that was supposed to speak, or was it
yeah,
me?
It doesn't matter.
Okay, so basically we are trying to, there's a memorial grant that basically the memorial grant that it's basically was awarded by or started by Ralph Goodale, the Minister for Safety and Corrections under Justin Trudeau. He lost his seat, I believe, right now, so he's no longer. But he started a fund that awards families of first responders with $300,000, and that includes in the line of duty death, as well as mental health death related deaths or other deaths. However, it was started in April of 2018, and we do not qualify. So it's and quite honestly, it's a bit of a we feel like a little stab against us, because we were being promised that money and it's just never materialized. And now when the government came out, it seems like they included mental health issues and basically made a cutoff of April of 2018, and we no longer qualify. So
I guess they sort of made a decision to support people from now on kind of deal who are suffering, as opposed to going back a few years. I mean, you guys have the same issues that other people who've lost loved ones recently are just starting to go through. You've been going through that for years, like the loss of homes. I mean, you can imagine that people would, although there are pension plans, I imagine, and bereavement plans in place, you still, the money's not coming in. You've lost half of an income usually.
Yes and no. In Ontario, we have Worksman's Compensation, so WSIB, that basically it's an insurance that when an officer's die or any person dies on a job, families do get support. So I want to make sure that's out in the open, because it is money that is coming in, so it's not like families are left completely. But that goes to everybody, first responders or anybody who's in construction. If it's a work-related injury or death, there is compensation, at least in Ontario, and I believe Canada-wide there is in other provinces similar insurance sort of systems.
Okay, well then what would you want from Goodall then? Or whoever his predecessor is?
Yeah, so basically we would like that the fund, the memorial grant that was started, that basically it would include the families retroactively, as it was promised going back to 2006. It was 2006, I believe, that we were being promised to have that grant started, and it's just government took their time to do it, and when they came out, they made it not retroactive. So families that were promised certain funding, we didn't simply get it. So we would like for them to go retroactively as it was promised.
Well, I think that, it's been said that it's hard to put a date on something like this. What you know, how far back do you go? It's a tricky question, isn't it?
It is. It is. And you know, it's something that we have to work through and see basically, you know, how it can be worked on. But, you know, we have right now under Memorial Fund, you have families that are being awarded, and you're not even, you know, if police officers who die of suicide, for example, those cases are often not, it's not determined. There's no system right now to say that the death of a particular officer was related to work, and if it was contributing factor or was it a leading factor in his death.
Mm-hmm. That would.
So this is where I would say some of the issue exists. While we recognize that definitely those families need as much help as we do, you know, there has to be some kind of system that basically will determine or test those cases and make sure that, you know, it is really work related.
Yeah. So does the government compensate for things like PTSD and the care that needs to go into a family that suffered a loss like this?
So a little bit. Basically, for me in particular, WSIB covered my psychological treatment for a year. I actually negotiated a little bit more because of the trial. I knew that the trial will be going on, and the trials, it's not my fault that it takes 2 years for the trial to go through. Basically, I was under psychologist care for 2.5 years, and WSIB covered all those fees. However, I know that there are some families who, let's say their spouses were in a car accident, basically after a year, it's cut off. The help is cut off. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, in some cases, it just depends, because, see, police forces are very, very different. Like, OPP has different rules, and Ottawa Police has different contracts. So it varies between the police force to police force, but you know, families do get also benefits, usually for a certain period of time, for their children as well as spouses. So there should be some coverage from that, but it varies between departments. So it's very difficult to say. Some people may, you know, may require more treatment, and there's simply not enough coverage. And I believe that's the issue that Luanne is running into.
Yes.
Yeah. And now your son, Luanne, he had a lot of, it was really tough on him losing Paul.
Yeah, he was 9, and he has over the years been diagnosed with complex PTSD, anxiety, depression. And so myself, like many families, and Anna's very correct, even for fire, like WSIB covers for the first year, but often, and I've talked to many who have had this situation, they're not ready to get that counseling that first year. They're still dealing with everything and coming to terms with everything. So it takes some time to get to that point. So by the time I went back for it, it was expired. So I didn't have that opportunity. What ended up happening is you end up putting tens of thousands. I put literally tens of thousands of dollars into mental health for support for Joshua and myself and over the years. And it's, you know, I've got one child. Imagine some of the families who have 4. Mm-hmm. Or 3 or 5. And so they're putting a lot of money into that, and they're not getting that type of support that they require. And as Anna said, all the departments are very different. It's inconsistent, really.
Right.
And one of my issues, Camp Faces is a wonderful organization, and they've helped a lot of people, including myself and Anna, as she said, and our children. But they only accept the kids up to the age of 18. So where my concern is, it's that 19 to 25 age group, mm-hmm, that they really struggle. And my son's not the only one. There's others that are having that same situation, but they have nowhere to go. So they have to turn to their community for getting counseling and whatnot. But again, that costs you money, and it can get to be quite expensive and problematic for families. So,
And Anna, do you have any children? Oh, did we lose her?
Oh, sorry. No, I'm sorry. I was on mute. I didn't want any sounds from my house.
Okay.
I have a son. So Eric had three children from a previous relationship. So they're adults. When Eric passed away, they were adults. But they were in late teen years. So it wasn't easy. And our son together was 3 years old and 3 months. So he was quite little.
Okay.
So. I have been very fortunate. Anthony has not required any psychological intervention at this point. However, from what I'm hearing from others, including Luanne, some of the symptoms, they come later. Years later, it's the childhood trauma that so many more nowadays we're talking about that actually appears later on in life. He seems to be okay right now, but I don't know what's coming.
And I guess none of us do you? It's
yes,
hard to
exactly.
It's
yeah.
hard to say what will come mm-hmm. down the pipeline. Well, we're running out of time, but I wanted to say thank you for joining us this morning, and thank you for sharing your story. I think it's really important that people know this, and that they understand that this is a situation that doesn't end after the reporters have taken down the story and life moves on to other things. For the family of the fallen firefighter or police officer, emergency services person, this is a lifetime. This is a lifetime of suffering and loss.
That's right. That's correct.
Well, thank you for joining us this morning. We appreciate you taking the time.
Thank you very much.
And if there's anything we can do to help with your crusade with the government, let us know, and we'll do another show.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Well, Luanne, thank you for sharing your contact so that we could have this show. I think it's really important that people know. And of course, as in most things in this world, as long as you know, I mean, people are going to say, well, firefighters and first responders have the best benefits package in the world. Why would they need even more compensation? Well, death in the line of duty is above and beyond the call of duty, I would say, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I would say that it's from our perspective. I mean, he's gone for good, and a lot of other families, and not just first responder families, they've gone through the same situation, and it's a lifetime. You know, it's it takes a moment for it to happen, but it lasts a lifetime, right?
Yeah, that's true. Well, we are going to take our top of the hour break. We've really appreciated you sharing this story with us this morning. For those of you staying on to listen to hour number two or part two of this Fresh Waves broadcast, we'll be talking in the next hour about Luanne's journey. I'm an expressive arts practitioner, so I use writing as a tool of healing. And it is a very therapeutic healing tool. Yeah. To be able to write your story or to write a story. It's a creative outlet. It's really beneficial in so many ways. And I would encourage anyone out there, if you don't want to one day become a published author, just the process of writing is so good for you. It really is. I know a cardiologist who told me that he will not do any open heart surgery, bypass surgery, or others that can wait till tomorrow afternoon, not an emergency situation. But he requires that the person, his patient, presents him with 10 written pages. He says he doesn't care what it's written about. It could be written about his dog. It could be written about the weather. It could be a rant about why he doesn't want to have surgery. But there has to be 10 written pages, because that's the beginning of the journey to healing.
Oh,
isn't that interesting?
I would agree, though.
There you go.
Yeah.
So we'll hear the rest of your story, the healing journey, and the fact that you're a published author now. Wow. We'll hear about that in hour number two. You're listening to Fresh Waves. I'm your host, Bren Masson.